Welcome to our satsang. We're going to have problems in the world, and we're going to have answers to those problems. So let's focus on trying to find an answer to all problems. Let's see if there is that first. Before we try to find answers to specific problems, let's see if we can find one that answers all problems. And indeed, there is one. We can call it unconditional love that is present with us right now. We can call it perfect peace. We can call it perfect oneness. We can call it seamlessness. We can call it pure awareness, pure consciousness. We can call it, you know, a lot of different terms. Experiencing this particular effect, we literally see that what we are has no problems, and therefore our problems are solved because we realize we don't have any. That's a different way of looking at it, isn't it? Instead of solving problems, we realize that we don't have any problems. What we are does not have any problems. What we imagine ourselves to be has a lot of problems. But we don't need to solve the problems of an imaginary identity, do we? Because we have a real identity that has no problems. So the real goal in this world is not to solve the world's problems, is to realize that what we are has no problems. A very different approach than what we're accustomed to. And just from hearing this, that should cause a shift. We're not trying to solve any problems. We're trying to realize we don't have any problems. How do we do that? We experience an effect that has no problems. Okay, it's kind of an intermediate step, really. We don't directly experience that we have no problems first. What we do is we experience an effect that is problem-free. And we tune into that effect. We abide in that effect. There's an effect that has no problems. And as we get used to paying attention to this effect that has no problems, we then remember what we are. And remember that we're problem-free as well. Okay? It's pretty simple, right? We have forgotten that we're problem-free. We have immersed ourselves in a dream of imagination which is absolutely chock-full of problems for the identity that we presume ourselves to be, this body, this mind, these emotions, these circumstances, and time and space. And this is just nothing but problems, an endless sea of potential problems for us. And this causes us to forget what we are. We forget that we're problem-free. So how do we remember? That's the big question, isn't it? We remember by choosing to experience an effect that is problem-free. We can call it unconditional love. There are no problems there. Not only does this effect have no problems, but we have no problems experiencing it, because nothing for us. It has no requirements of us. It does not even require us to maintain what it is. It's maintenance-free. Maintenance-free. It would have to be, right, that if something was problem-free, it would have to be maintenance-free. Because here I look at this house, this place, and nothing but problems. Ton of maintenance. You know, constant maintenance. It's a headache. The better it is, the more maintenance you need to make to keep it from losing its edge. It's like you have a beautiful car and you want to keep it clean, and all this dust and grime and everything keeps getting on it, you know, and you struggle so hard to keep it really immaculate looking. Whereas if you have an old junker, you don't care. You don't care. But still, all sorts of problems, maintenance problems. So we need to experience an effect. We need our experience to be centered on a problem-free experience. Problem-free effect, problem-free experience. Very simple. And there is such a problem-free experience. This is the testimony of the great sages of history. They have found this problem-free experience, and they simply pay attention to it. And that's it. There's no problem with their experiencing. The experience remains problem-free. They don't have to maintain the experience. The experience doesn't become demanding. It doesn't have a to-do list for us. It doesn't need protection. It doesn't need our protection. It doesn't need any cleaning, dusting. Don't have to give it a wash. Don't have to give it a bath. It doesn't need any sleep. Doesn't need any medicine. Doesn't need to be taken anywhere. Doesn't need to be fed. Doesn't need to get a haircut. Doesn't need to go to the doctor. Doesn't need to go to the dentist or the eye doctor. Doesn't need to go to school. Doesn't get Alzheimer's. Doesn't age. Doesn't get senile. Doesn't become irrational or erratic. Doesn't go on trips or vacations. Doesn't judge us. Doesn't ask for our resume. Doesn't ask for a price of admission. This is a problem-free effect. This is unconditional love. And by experiencing this, we remember what we are. We remember that, we're problem-free. Our identity is problem-free. And we tried to forget what we were by introducing a scenario full of problems and a identity that was completely vulnerable, inherently vulnerable, potentially vulnerable in every way, a body. Body is just a vulnerability device. And we said that we are this body. Pay attention to this body. What happens to it is what happens to us. All sorts of problems. The problem-free effect cannot burn down, cannot be burned, cannot be destroyed, cannot be distorted, cannot be harmed, cannot be changed, cannot be modified. And all this enables us to remember what we are. So literally, again, we're not trying to solve the problems of the world. We're trying to experience a problem-free effect. This is the real purpose of existence, the real purpose that we can give it. Initially, the purpose has been to forget what we are, so that we can pretend to be prime creators. We can pretend to be something that we're not. Something different than what we are. But what we really want is to experience being prime creator, which is something different than what we are. Because we are spirit, prime created. And so we have this scenario of deep, deep forgetfulness of what we are. So we need a scenario of deep, deep remembrance of what we are. And since what we are is problem free, the only way we can remember this is to have a experience of problem free effect. An immaculate effect, problem-free. And just look at it. Just experience it. That's the purpose now we give it to existence. Our purpose in existence is to experience this problem-free effect. Before, we wanted to experience problems. Now, we want to experience an effect that has no problems. Sure, the world continues on, the problems of the world continue, but we're centered on the problem-free effect. Everything else is like vague shadows in the distance, at a distance, as it were. Very much unimportant, because it no longer suits our purpose, no longer serves our purpose, so it fades back into obscurity. And all we have to do is marvel at this problem-free effect, enjoy it, experience it, abide in it. Effect that doesn't increase or decrease, doesn't change, is untroubled by all change around it. It's not seeking anything. It's perfectly content to be what it is. At all times, is present right now, is always present. This is the problem-free effect. This is unconditional love, no conditions on anything. We experience no problem with it. It's right here, right now. It's just if we change our purpose to remember what we are, then we can experience that effect. But if we keep our purpose on forgetting what we are so we can pretend to be something different than what we are, then we are bound to problems. Because having problems, of course, is the way that we forget what we are. It's the mechanism of forgetfulness. Whatever those problems may be, they could be sickness. They could be destitution. Poverty. Lack. Stress of all types. Vulnerabilities. Instabilities. On and 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 on. Endless potential for problems in this world with a body as having the purpose of forgetting what we are so we can pretend to be something different than what we are. We can pretend to be greater than what we are. Even though we're everything, we did not give rise to everything. You see, the Prime Creator did. So we are not Prime Creator. We cannot become Prime Creator. Everything is already established. If we forget reality, if we forget what we are, if we forget the laws of reality, forget everything like that, go into a deep state of forgetfulness, then we can imagine, pretend that we are the Prime Creator. We can pretend that, and that's what we're doing. That is what we're doing. And in order to do that, we have to experience problems, and sometimes the problems get very, very, very severe. Why? Why do problems become very severe? They become very severe because we want to go into severe forgetfulness of what we are. And we want to do that because this severe forgetfulness of what we are enables us to pretend even more that we're Prime Creator. We get an ego boost. That's what it means. Pretending to be something that we're not is the ego, an ego boost. And so as long as we're focused on problems, we're getting that ego boost. And the worse the problems are, the greater the ego boost. And we think that if we just have perfect problems, we'll become Prime Creator. If we just experience complete chaos, that somehow this will change and we'll be able to change us. And we'll completely forget what we are, and therefore our pretenses, there'll be nothing to to give the lie to our pretenses. You know, that's the ego's goal, that our pretenses will be unopposed by any factual, actuality. that we somehow will forget so perfectly that nothing can oppose our pretenses anymore. That's literally the goal that we have. Pretty strange goal. It's kind of a magical goal, really. That's our goal, that we forget to such an extent, such a profound forgetting, that our pretenses aren't opposed by anything, and therefore, for us, they become real. There's no objections. There's no comparison. There's nothing that can interfere with our pretension. That's what we're hoping for, and we hope that, you know, perfect suffering will bring about this, perfect forgetfulness, which will bring about, again, the pretense will become real. Guess what? It does not become real. What happens when we experience total chaos is we jump back from it because we can't stand it. You see, what we actually are cannot stand that. So it jumps back from it. We cannot abide in total chaos. We cannot. So the ego's goal, really, of abiding in perfect chaos can never be reached. I tried it. I actually experienced pure chaos, but only for a moment, because it was impossible to maintain it. Impossible. What we are rejects it, jumps back from it. I'm saying it's absolutely impossible for anyone to abide in perfect chaos. So the ego's goal is futile. It's not only futile because truth could never be replaced or changed. It's also futile because we cannot abide in perfect chaos. It's impossible. And even if we could, by abiding in perfect chaos, how could we become then something different? We do not. Again, I can tell you that it's simply we reject the pure chaos, and then we realize that this is not the way. It can never work. So nothing magical happens. Nothing magical happens. The ego says, well, we need to abide in that perfect chaos, perfect forgetfulness. Cannot. You cannot do it. So the ego really has nothing to offer. Its plan doesn't work. This plan can never work. So why do we continue to give the ego some slack? We shouldn't. Instead, we should admit defeat. Let's repent. Admit defeat. Repent. Admit defeat. Can't do it. Cannot do it. I wanted to see if the ego's path worked. I wanted to see, so I went along and experienced pure chaos, and then I realized that I cannot abide in this. It's impossible. So the ego's path doesn't work. So then I said, okay, what does work? And now we're back towards experiencing the problem-free effect, unconditional love. No problems. It's no problem because we're pre-qualified. We don't have to qualify for it. There's no requirements to enter into it. So there's no problem at all. It's just there. It just is. It's already there. We don't have to manufacture it. We don't have to sustain it. It's just there. It's the effect of not trying to be prime creator, not trying to change what we are. We choose the idea of not trying to change what we are, not trying to be prime creator. The effect of that arises is an unchanging effect, problem-free. It's not trying to be something other than what it is at all. So there's no struggle. There's no conflict. And all the problems that this arises, there's no effort to break down into chaos. None of that. Problem free. It's already present. All we have to do is to make a choice in that direction. Admit defeat, admit we cannot become Prime Creator. We cannot abide in chaos. There is no magical phoenix out of the ashes of chaos that arises. There's simply a rejection of it and a desire to remember what we really are. That's all that happens. We just kind of say, yuck, that's terrible. I can't stand that. That's not going to work for me. And then the ego, you know, begins to lose its grasp on us. I remember the ego got so mad when I, rejected the pure chaos. And I didn't reject it. I mean, what I am rejected it. Because I am spirit, I am truth. And there's no meaning in perfect chaos, none. And so we cannot abide in no meaning whatsoever. And nothing, no meaning. Because we are reality, we are truth, we are meaning. And so there was a recoil from it. And then the ego got really mad at me and cursed me, you know, and said I was nothing. I was completely stupid, completely nothing, the worst of the worst, and literally tried to destroy my spirit because it was so upset that I could not abide in the pure chaos and therefore carry out its advice. Because it thought it almost succeeded, you know. Here's someone who's experiencing the pure chaos. It almost succeeded, and yet I recoil. And the ego says, ah, foiled again. And it's just so angry about that. It feels betrayed, you know, that somehow we betrayed it. And that we're so stupid. We could have done it if we weren't so stupid, if we weren't so terrible, if we weren't just the worst entity, identity ever. We could have done it. That's what the ego says. The ego cannot admit defeat. It only blames. The ego cannot say, oh, it's impossible to abide in pure chaos. No, the ego will blame us and say that we're incompetent. That's the reason the ego gives us. So it was really terrible, I'll tell you that, to have the ego turn on you and just say that you are absolutely the worst nothing possible and you're a complete failure and see you as a zero is shocking. But then I said, wow, you know, this is horrible. Who thinks that I'm worthy? And then the Holy Spirit showed up and said, yeah, you're very worthy, entirely worthy. Let's start remembering what you really are. So I said, that sounds good to me, because the ego has given up on me. It's rejected me entirely, completely rejected, because I couldn't carry out its plan, you know. I wanted to see what the ego's plan is really about, and I found out. So the ego's plan runs into an obstacle, an unpassable impasse, runs into an impasse, a complete 100% impasse. And we have nothing to do at that point except to turn around. It's an impasse. Curiously enough, this world is going to reach an impasse. You know, I didn't realize I was going to reach an impasse, but suddenly I did. I came upon pure chaos as an experience. Very surprising. Same thing with this world. This world is going to reach an impasse because it's following the advice of the ego. The ego's advice always is to drive us into pure chaos. Believe it or not, but I certainly believe it because I've experienced it. We may think that the ego is our friend, but it is always setting us up for pure chaos. It wants us to experience that and abide in it. Now, let us bring this home to whoever at right now, as I've spoken in another video, saying the world is headed for some severe troubles. The ego has set all this up. The ego wants us to experience these troubles. It wants the world to be in a state of pure chaos. It wants to bring chaos to the world. It wants us to experience that chaos. It wants to live. Wants us to live in that chaos. It wants us to abide in it, because it thinks that this is pure magic, and that out of this pure magic will arise a new creation, a new creator, a new creation, free of what we have been up to this point, free of reality. Reality will cease to be, and a new reality will spring forth if we abide in that chaos long enough. So really what the ego is having us do, insists on us doing, is to stay within the context of troubles, severe troubles. And what I'm saying is, we don't have to do that, because we cannot abide within pure chaos. It's futile. It doesn't work. We reject it. And even if we didn't reject it, there is no pure magic that can destroy reality and create a new reality. It's all a complete failure on the ego's part, okay? So, if something is doomed to failure from the very beginning, there is no necessity to pursue it. There's no necessity to try and prove anything. There's nothing to prove. So the ego will bring about severe chaos on this planet. And I've said it will do this by the mechanism of the sun producing a tremendous solar flare that directs a massive cloud of high energy particles, making a direct hit on the Earth, melting down our electronics, basically. And by doing that, paralyzing the commerce, distribution, transportation, functionality of the entire planet. And out of that will then emerge the currents of chaos. And what the ego wants us to do is it wants us to remain here in this world and just suffer through it. Seriously, just wants us to suffer. That's its purpose. It wants us to suffer so badly that magic arises from it and a new creation arises from it. I tell you, this is all complete folly. Nothing will arise from it except suffering. You get all the suffering and you get nothing out of it. Except then the ego becoming furious at you for failing to suffer enough. See, you can never suffer enough to bring about a new creation. But the ego, that's the ego's goal, and insists that you must do that. So no matter how much you suffer, the ego, eventually you'll say, I can't suffer anymore, it's enough, and the ego will reject you entirely and saying, you didn't suffer enough. If you had kept suffering more, the magic would have come. But you're a complete failure, and it will reject you. So literally, all you have to look forward to from the ego is complete rejection. The ego will reject you completely at some point when you finally decide all this suffering is not working. This chaos, I recoil from it. I reject it. I can't help it. It's something within me that is rejecting it, no matter what I do. That's the reality that we are that is rejecting it. So again, all we have to look forward to with the ego is suffering, 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 and finally total rejection. That's it. And knowing that, why would we even play the ego's game at all? Why not choose to experience a problem-free effect instead of the suffering? And in the case of this world, why not go to another place instead of staying here and experiencing the meltdown and the chaos and the suffering and the misery, which leads to more misery and suffering and more meltdown, which gets worse and worse and worse and worse and worse. And all the while the ego telling us we got to hang in there, suffer more, suffer more, suffer more, waiting for the magic to happen, and it never happens. So we get nothing out of it. Literally come away with nothing but a bitter experience. That is the truth of the situation. So, of course, I say, sidestep it. That's the only sane thing to do. If you see what the facts are, that's the only sane thing to do. Not sidestepping it is insane, because you'll get nothing out of it. The ego, again, the purpose of the ego is to drive us into pure chaos, and that's its purpose. Make no mistake about that, the ego, I have seen the ego has the agencies in this world already, that their sole focus is to drive this world into total chaos. And not only on this planet, but in the cosmos and the solar system, the ego is setting everything up for this direct hit on us. It has already set our society up for total chaos, because everything's based on electronics now, you see. That was the big mistake this world made, which I tried to warn the world about, and many have, saying, don't go forward with this high-tech progress. Cut it off. Forget about it. You're going into a trap. And we walk right into the trap. The agents of the ego set it all up. This whole world is wired now as a trap for us, because we're vulnerable to a severe hit, directed by a very strong solar flare, or a succession of them. You know, lesser solar flares won't do it, but a gigantic cloud, plasma cloud of high energy particles, and first come the X-rays, severe X-rays, and then later, higher energy particles, a direct hit will fry the electronics, shut them down, mess them up. And our entire civilization on this planet now is dependent on that. So again, guess who set that all up? It wasn't the Holy Spirit, I'll tell you that. I can tell you for a fact the Holy Spirit has never asked me to develop any sort of technology at all. Anything that's vulnerable to a solar flare has never asked me to do anything like that. Not even the slightest bit. I wouldn't have the slightest idea how to invent or make or produce or manufacture anything high tech at all. No idea. It's really the manufacturing of vulnerability is what it is. And once the whole planet now has become based on the foundation of vulnerability, the kill shot comes, the planet sinks into absolute tremendous chaos, the ego gets what it wants. And the ego tells everybody, hey, just hang with it. Magic will happen, pure magic will happen. No, it won't. The ego tells anyone who leaves the planet that they'll miss out on this magic, this pure magic. No, they won't. The only thing they'll miss out on is extreme chaos, extreme misery, extreme suffering, and then extreme rejection by the ego. That's all that they'll miss out on. And that's not really missing out on anything, is it? So hear these words well and let them sink in, because having tested out the ego, I know what it's all about. I know that the ego's goal is to push us into pure chaos. And I know the ego has booby-trapped this planet for that to happen. It's completely obvious to me. Knowing what the ego's goal is, I can look out and see, you know, what is the ego doing in the world? Well, it's obvious what it's doing. All of the means of transportation are all chipped with sophisticated electronics. You fry those electronics, your car's going nowhere. Which is why a lot of people are riding bicycles right now, tell you the truth. A lot of people realize something, this is going to happen. And so you see them out riding their bicycles and walking, etc. Of course, when you ride your bicycle down to the market and there's nothing there because none of the trucks can drive, that's a problem. Which is why you see a lot of people planting victory gardens, local agriculture in their yards, so they don't have to walk down to the market. But You know, how much can you really plant in your yard is the question. And how can you stop other people from coming in the middle of the night and taking your crops? You see? So it becomes very, very problematical, the whole situation. So the chaos, you may have a farm somewhere where you're sustainable, but other people will also see this and they say, hey, I want, you know, what you have. And so it becomes just a massive, massive, free-for-all, terrible situation here. All by design. It's all designed by the ego. The ego is the master designer of suffering. We have to realize the purpose of existence is suffering. Because the ego thinks it can derive magic out of that suffering. Why? Because the suffering causes us to forget what we are. And the ego believes that out of this forgetfulness of what we are springs some kind of magical power to create a new self. But the truth is, nothing comes out of it at all. Zero. What comes out of suffering is zero. Magic is merely symbolic. It has no effect on reality whatsoever. I hope this audio is working. I'm trying a new audio approach here. Because this is a very, very good satsang. As usual, I push the envelope, push the limits forward. There's no reason to do it otherwise. We have to be pleasantly shocked by what we hear. We're hearing things like the only purpose of existence is suffering. That's what it's made for. It's a torture chamber designed to produce the magic of a new self, a new creation. And it never accomplishes that. It can never accomplish it. It's futile from the very beginning. And we need to see that. We can't go into denial about it. If we see it and we realize it's futile, we'll choose instead the problem-free idea. Problem-free effect, because that reminds us of what we are. And for most of us, we're maybe not quite ready to choose a problem, to experience a problem-free effect. So the next best thing is to sidestep the chaos of the planet. If one had chosen to experience a problem-free effect perfectly, then they can literally stay here on this planet and not be affected by anything. Nothing will bother them at all. Nothing. But we're not at that point. Very, very, very few are at that point. We're probably close to that. Okay, but we're there yet. So the next best thing is to sidestep it and go to another dwelling place. Cosmos is full of dwelling places. Probably uncountable. Many of them better than this place, for sure. Places where the ego has not set up such a sophisticated trap as it has done here. So the chaos may be a little more easy to sidestep. Like for in the past here on this planet, there have been chaos of wars, etc., and people were able to sidestep those by going to other places. So there's always been a sidestepping process on this planet. But right now, the way the whole world is set on a foundation of electronics, there isn't anywhere a place you can go in this world to sidestep it, really. Not really. So the sidestepping now takes to a greater level, sidestep it by going to a different locale, different dwelling place other than this planet. Because literally the catastrophes, the ego has a whole blueprint, a whole slew of troubles coming. It's going to apply the ultimate in suffering to this planet. This planet is going to be crucified. I tell you the truth that Jesus, the crucifixion of Jesus was actually a symbolic way of warning us what's going to happen to this planet. It's going to be absolutely crucified. And then the resurrection is showing that what we are truly are is unaffected by the crucifixion of this planet. But all of that scourging and beating, you know, the terrible, terrible, terrible whipping and torture that took place, that was a warning to the world saying, this is what the ego is going to do to you if you choose to remain in this planet, on this planet, and choose to continue on with the ego's goals of magic. Some kind of magical new power to create ourselves, create a new self for ourselves. There's no such power. It can never arise. But the ego believes that by scourging this planet, it will attain this power. So that's what it's going to do. And we have been warned of this, and we've been told also that we have the option to go to another place. Jesus said very plainly when he left, he said, I'm going to come back at the end of the age. Meaning, I'm going to come back when the ego springs its trap and take you to another dwelling place that I prepared for you. Very simple, very basic, and very direct. There's no magic there. It's the escape from the pursuit of magic. It's a turning away from the pursuit of magic. Jesus said, just go to a really nice place here. And there, spend your time in self-inquiry and contemplation and turning towards experiencing the problem-free effect, which will remind you of what you are. That's all. Don't continue to pursue the ego's objective of suffering and misery and chaos and hoping for that will produce some sort of magical effect that you'll be able to be prime creators. It's impossible. Futile. This is literally what we have prepared for, what we have in store for us. We think we're in a sophisticated society, and we are, but that sophistication was a trap. All those satellites in the sky, we think, oh, how sophisticated we are. They'll all be out of work, out of commission. They'll all be out of commission, all of them. And that's just the beginning. The grid, the transformers, old electrical grid, will go down. The transformers will blow. On and on and on and on and on. The ego set it all up. There's a reason why the Amish people do what they do, because they've been informed of this. And they have some wisdom, and that they realize, do not build a society upon modern technology. So everything that they do is not vulnerable to this. However, because they're in the world, they are vulnerable to the chaos, because people will come for what they have. And again, the solar kill shot will bring about a lot more problems in the world. We'll heat it up. The world will heat up. And really, as it said in the scriptures, that if it weren't for the time being cut short, no life would survive on this planet. Okay. So in other words, it's really a series of very, very bad catastrophes and problems, all set up by the purpose of existence, the ego, trying to get that total chaos, abiding in total chaos, from which it believes the real magic can be found, some kind of real magic can be found. And it's completely insane about this. It doesn't work. I can testify 100% for sure. That's impossible. Because what we are is life, is truth, is reality. And that cannot abide in total chaos. It rejects it. Reality rejects it, and so it has no power. That's a fact. Can't change that fact. What we are turns away from total chaos. Automatically, without any thought process involved. Automatically. So that's it. Game over. Game over for the ego. But the ego, you know, continues. It just will reject you again. It'll just say, well, you don't know what you're talking about. You're incompetent. That's what it told me. I'm completely incompetent. I didn't fail because what I am turned away from it and rejected it. The ego insists that I failed because I'm incompetent. So that's all you get. You suffer, you suffer, you suffer, and then you finally turn away from the chaos, and the ego claims you're just incompetent and rejects you entirely. That's what you have to look forward to in this world. So that is why people have preached really throughout history. Really, you got to take this seriously. They call it, you know, heaven or hell sort of thing, which is a very strong way to put it. And in some ways, you can see that there's some validity to that. It's not that you're going to burn in hell forever, because you will turn away from it. What you are rejects total chaos, rejects that suffering and misery. It realizes that total chaos doesn't work, so what's the point of all this suffering? No point to it. So we'll start going away from it. But for those who really are very loyal to the ego and really want to be prime creator, they're certainly going to burn. There's no question about it. But again, it won't be forever. They will eventually say that this isn't, I can't take it anymore. I'll turn away from it. And the others, they will go to a place that's very, very wonderful. And in that place, they will be able to, they will feel more capable of choosing to experience a problem-free effect, which is even beyond any dwelling place. It's superior to even the greatest dwelling place. The problem-free effect is greater than any dwelling place, any world. Way, way, way beyond any world can ever be. Because this effect literally gives a perfect reminder of what we really are. And what we are is completely beyond worlds, even beyond the universe. So I'm sure this satsang has got us thinking. And again, it's simply, if you see it clearly and simply, then you realize, it's not such a tough thing to figure out. The ego's plan doesn't work. The ego's plan is suffering. It doesn't work. It has to be rejected. I have to then turn towards remembering what I am, because forgetfulness of what I am will never bring me anything but more suffering. The Buddha said existence is nothing but suffering, which is true. That's all it is. But we think we're going to get something out of suffering, which is why we stay with it. But again, once we hit that impasse of total chaos, then we realize we're not getting anything out of it. It's all been a sham. It's all been a waste of time. It's a dead end. What do you do when you realize you've hit a dead end? You turn around, go back. That's it. Nothing more than that. And of course, the ego all the way is screaming at you that you're incompetent, that there wasn't really a dead end, that you just didn't stick with it long enough, which is nonsense. So there you go. ABCs of the situation. These are just the ABCs. That's all you need. Learn the ABCs and you got it. And the troubles are certainly coming up. I mean, this the kill shot, solar flare kill shot, won't happen until the world is really set up for it, and it's already set up for it. It hasn't happened yet because the world was not sufficiently dependent on sophisticated electronic circuitry and communications, etc. But now it is. Now it's very, very set up. So the ego is not going to waste any time. The ego's afraid that maybe we'll change it, you know, and get wise to its plan and decide, well, wait a minute, let's all become like the Amish people or something like that. So that once the ego gets it set up, it's not going to wait around. It's going to strike. It's going to pull out its blitzkrieg. It's the ultimate blitzkrieg is blitzkrieg from the sun. And that's a stealth blitzkrieg. Comes like a thief in the night. No warning, so to speak. We'll have a very short warning period. Very short. Very short. We might get the warning like there's been a massive eruption on the sun and it looks like it's coming toward us. But then they'll say, but we can't be sure that it's going to hit us or how bad it will be. You know, they'll say that. And then after that, communications will go down, most likely, very quickly. So we'll have, you know, maybe, I don't know how much of a warning, very short, minuscule. Like Jesus said, it'll come like a thief in the night. Of course, a thief that comes in the night, you never see him coming. Before you know it, they're already in the house. Now, I don't know exactly how the shift to another dwelling place will take place. Before this happens, right after it's happened, or after a little while, when you know, once things break down and people start realizing the trouble they're in, it could occur in stages. It could kind of be just an ongoing thing. All those are possibilities. But we don't have to be victims of the ego's insanity and simply, you know, hole up in a drowning ship like the Titanic and people being trapped in their cabins and going down with the ship. We don't have to do that. There'll be lifeboats. There'll be enough lifeboats this time. Not like the Titanic, where there weren't enough lifeboats. And even then, some wouldn't get in the lifeboats. Basically, we just say to the ego, you know, your rejection of us has no authority, has no truth to it. Your claim that we're incompetent has no truth to it. That's only, you know, sour grapes. It's a failure to realize that the goal is impossible. How can we be said to be incompetent if we fail to reach an impossible goal? Well, what kind of reason is that? It's none. There's no reason there at all. None. Truth is not contrary to reason. Neither is reality. Faith can be contrary. Belief can be contrary to reality, but not reason. So we're not incompetent. We're just wise. We got wise to the ego, that's all. Of course, the ego will bitterly complain that those who leave are losers, the worst kind of losers, totally incompetent, deserving of the most severe punishment possible. They're going to be annihilated because they're losers, you know. They gave up, they quit, they'll never get anything. They won't get to experience the magic. They'll be, once the magic comes and creates a new kingdom, they'll be annihilated. That's what the ego says. So try it, you know, it's very frightening what the ego says. Very intimidating. But it's sheer nonsense. It's just blathering, gibberish. That? I don't know. Well, animals moving about here in the dark. Maybe drip systems suddenly going on. I don't know. But what time is it? Well, it's only 10:20. But it's time to talk about all this stuff very plainly. Existence is nothing but suffering. That is very true. We've talked about unconditional love, the problem-free effect that has no conditions for us. We have no problem experiencing it. We have no problem maintaining the experiencing of it. Problem-free. Of course, the only thing, reason why we hold back is we're still hoping that magic will come through for us, that our suffering will give us something. Because once we choose the problem-free experience, we're not suffering anymore. So we're still thinking, well, I need to suffer a little bit, because maybe I'll get more than what this effect can give me. Maybe I can be a little bit more than what I really am, you know. But we're still thinking that. Of course we cannot become something that we're not, but we try to fudge that and say, well, we can become a little bit different than how we were created. A little bit. A little bit of magic is true. See, that is not the case. We cannot become even a tiny bit different than how we were created. Not even a tiny bit. So we will continue to hold on to suffering until we finally realize that. That there is never will be any effect on reality. Reality cannot be changed. There's no magic at all. Zero. To change reality, zero. And then we'll just choose the problem-free experience. Not trying to rely on any magic anymore, any suffering anymore. And the problem-free experience, no more suffering, no more misery. We might be afraid of it if we experience it a little bit. We say, well, wait a minute, there's no suffering there. How am I going to become great? But we're already perfect. We just need to be reminded of that. We might feel that the problem-free experience is trying to steal something from us because it doesn't give us any suffering. And we equate suffering with progress and magical self-creation. And so we have valued it for so long. We look at the problem-free experience and we were afraid. We're saying, where is the suffering? I don't see it. How can we get something special out of it? We can't get anything special. We can't get anything different out of it. It's problem free. It's not changing. And so initially we might look at it skeptically. And what we do need to keep looking at, even through our skepticism, we have to continue to look at it. And realize our skepticism is misplaced. It's just that we've been so long trusting in the ego that we're skeptical of this. But what we're doing here in Satsang is looking at that skepticism and seeing it's not justified. And that will gradually lessen the skepticism. And we want to get it to the point where we decide to sidestep the ego's little drama here in this world, our big drama. So we can get it there. We can get it that far. And that's enough. That's enough, basically, for now. That's very helpful. It's not the ultimate. Shifting to another place, sidestepping the calamities is not the ultimate. We still have to examine our skepticism towards the ultimate reminder. But we need to be in a situation where we actually do that. We were not immersed in chaos. So really we're choosing between being immersed in chaos or giving a lot of time to satsang. Towards examining our skepticism, which is what we're doing, and seeing it's ill-founded. It's not founded on any truth at all. So gradually we see this. All right. I hope that this has, the audio has recorded here. I'm not sure that it has. You might have to crank up the volume on this, because I'm using the volume on the camera, the webcam, for this. So maybe you put the volume all, you probably had to have it all the way up, all the way through. Hopefully it's smooth and clear. I'm not sure it will be. So let's stop this and we will find out how it went. All right. Very great. That is it.